tried. I've had my fill, my share of losing, and now as tears subside, I find it all so amusing. Yes, there were times, I'm sure you knew, when I bit off more than I could chew. But through it all, when there was doubt, did all that, and may I say, not in a shy way, oh no, oh no, not me, I did it my way. Yes, there were times, I'm sure you knew, when I bit off more than I could chew. But through it all, when there was doubt, I ate it up and spit it out. The record shows I took the blow.
Everyone, today I bring to you a dialogue with movie actress Shabana Azmi. Shabana has acted in more than 160 movies, most of them from parallel cinema, some of them from mainstream cinema as well. Born to Urdu poet Kaifi Azmi and theater actress Shaukat Kaifi, Shabana has imbibed their creativity, curiosity, and concern for social justice in her own imagination. We talk about her career, her dreams, and her experience as an actress in both movies and theater. Shabana remains fiercely optimistic about preserving the diverse culture of India. So let's talk to Shabana. Hello, Shabana. Thanks for joining this dialogue.
It's a pleasure. Thank you for having me.
And I really want to preserve this dialogue for future generations. So think of like a 15-year-old, 12 to 15-year-old kid who's seeking to be inspired to define her future and taps into this resource of like, how has the past been? What kind of a legacy of ideas and imagination has she inherited from free India? So that's what this is going to be about. And from that perspective, I want to start with a simple question. When I look at your career in theater and in cinema, there's a certain kind of theme that emerges in the types of stories your movies and your theater have told. Are you able to articulate what that general theme seems to be?
Yes, I grew up in a family that believed art should be used as an instrument of social change. Till the age of 9, I lived in a commune of the Communist Party where a celebration of India's plurality, a composite culture, gender equality, all these things were given. There was a celebration of all festivals, but a complete absence of religion. And this was in my DNA. I didn't have to think about it. This was just there. This was something that I just witnessed. And I grew up, in fact, believing that the world is a place where you have to fight for social justice and where gender equality is a given. India's composite culture is a given. And it was only when I was about 19 years old that I realized that, particularly when it came to gender equality, what I was experiencing at home was an exception rather than the rule. And then from then on, it went. But because my mother was involved with Prithvi Thiyatre and with IPTA, which were doing meaningful plays, and I was sort of hanging around because my parents didn't believe in keeping the kids away. So anything that they did, the kids were included. So at one hand, I was taken to theater with my mother, and I was taken to mushairas with my father. Both my brother Baba and I, as very little children, remember going to sleep on the big bolsters, behind the big bolsters on the mushairas, and then waking up when there was a great applause, because we always knew that that great applause followed my father's recitation. I also was taken by my father to the Mazdoor Kisan meetings. And as a little child, I was really fussed over. And the Mazdoor people would just hold me on their shoulders and pass me around. And there was much celebration. So I thought red was the color of celebration and of party time. So it was a very beautiful time in India when I was growing up.
This is so beautiful. It literally, I can relate to everything that you said, because this is exactly what happened with me. Mm-hmm. Of course, my father came from the socialist background as opposed to communist. But my mother was in the cultural troupe of Rashtra Seva Dal. And she would go and do tamashas around in Maharashtra. She and Liladhar Hegde and Vasant Bapat, they would like put these cultural programs through which like evoking all of these values, social justice, women's emancipation, and so on. And I would sit exactly like that in the audience or in the wings and watch everything. So I can completely relate to what you're saying.
Mm-hmm.
So then when did you actually get drawn into being a part of theater?
Much, much later. Mm-hmm. Much, much later. See, I was doing theater at an amateur level in all through school. And then in college, we realized that there was only English theater and there was no Hindi theater. So Farooq Sheikh was 2 years my senior, we formed the Hindi Natya Manch. And we started doing Hindi plays for the first time in St. Xavier's College. And then we did that for 3 years. And every single year, we won all the intercollegiate.
Wow. And this is much before Tumari Amrita, right?
Oh God, this is in college. I'm talking about 67. I mean, 60, yeah, starting from 68, 69, 70, around that period.
Right.
So I did, I was doing, and of course, this was just amateur theater. But it was something that I enjoyed, and we used to, it used to be wonderful because we had absolutely no money to put up the plays, and there was nothing that we would get from college. So most of the money would be put in by Farooq. And then we used to perform at Tejpal Hall. So my friend Parna, who was around the corner, we would raid her drawing room and pull all her furniture out and use that furniture. And then when we would win all the awards, what we would do is we would win like about 150 rupees because it was 50 rupees for best actor, 50 rupees for best actress, and 150, I think, for the best player or something. So Farooq had to come and drop me. This was in Tejpal, which is in town, and I was living in Juhu. So he had to drop me all the way to Juhu. So what we would do is we would hire a cab and then take one cab in front at the back and say, oh, this is our entourage. And that was the fine thing that we could do. And that's what we did. But sorry, I have to tell you that we shifted from the commune to the, at the age of nine, it sort of the commune broke up and all that, and everybody went and had their own homes. And we shifted to a very small cottage in Juhu, which was a very, sort of, it was considered back of beyond then. But I insisted that I'd go through the same school, which was Queen Mary's school. So it was a very tough journey. I had to take a bus from Juhu bus depot to Santa Cruz station, which was about 10 stops. And then from there, I had to catch the train for 14 stops from Santa Cruz to Grant Road. And then I had to walk about 15 minutes from there to go to school. Now, my mother sent a maid with me only for 3 months. And then at the age of nine, can you imagine, I used to do this entire journey on my own. And obviously, that built a lot of confidence in me. Today, when I see how crazy mothers are going when it comes to their children and their children being dropped and how everybody has to be dropped just by car and all of that, I just think that a lot of the confidence that I got was because of that. Because at the age of nine, if I was negotiating through the streets and train stations of Bombay at that time, that gave me a lot of confidence. So also in my upbringing, there was this constant instilling of independence, never spoken about, but just sort of taken for granted.
Mm-hmm. So, but do you think that independence came because you were in a city? If you were in a rural area, would you have had the same kind of independence?
I would think so. I mean, I haven't given it much thought, but because mobility is less in rural areas, maybe that would have been a bit of an issue. It's just a question of mobility.
But also the mindset of Mumbai is because everybody is struggling, everybody is fast. There's this basic mindset of supporting each other and letting people be and like almost like coexisting. Whereas in village, there are a lot of norms and social practices and traditions that also frame your life, right?
No, and also great social hierarchies. My father was born in a small village in Azamgarh, in a tiny village called Mijma. And they were landlords of that place. But my grandmother says that at the age of seven, Kaifi would not agree to have new clothes made on Eid because the farmer's children couldn't afford to get new children. So he was different from the rest of the family.
So I have a question. I want to go back there. How did your father become a communist? What was he inspired by?
There was this different seed in him. And then it's a very interesting story because three of my father's sisters died due to TB. And it was believed that because the children were being sent to an English school, that God's wrath was falling upon them. And so they took my father out of Mijwa and sent him to Sultanul Madaris in Lucknow, which was the biggest madarsa of that area. Within 3 months, my father formed a union there and went on strike, and he was thrown out of the madarsa. From there, he then sort of got involved in Gandhi's movement of getting clothes burnt and all that. And there's a very interesting story about how he wanted to join jail. He thought it was a very good thing to do, etc., etc. But then he went to Kanpur. And in Kanpur, he was working with a shoe factory. And he started writing his political poetry, which reached Sardar Jafri and Sajjad Zahir, and they called him. And so at the age of 19, he came and joined the Communist Party and started writing for the paper Qaumi Jung. That's how he came to Bombay.
So one just another diversion. So he was kind of triggered by Gandhi and he chose Communist Party. What views did he hold of Gandhi as he moved into the Communist Party?
Well, Gandhi was not a favorite of the Communist Party, as you
I know.
But Nehru, they respected a lot. So there was a lot of respect for Nehru. And then Gandhi sort of went... And in any case, Gandhi died in 48. Mm-hmm. So my father was sort of just getting married. He got married in 47, etc. So Gandhi went out and Nehru continued to be a hero for him for a long time.
Okay, I understand. So now moving back to your evolution of, as a child, what did you want to become? Did you have a dream of becoming something?
You know, I was a great fibber. I used to tell a lot of stories. So I was in this small little commune where I had one, we were living, the family was living out of a small room, which was just 180 to 220 square feet. And there were 8 families that shared one toilet and one bathroom. And so, I was in an English school, Queen Mary's. So I used to tell my friends that actually I live in New York and I take a plane to New York every weekend. And I am, Enid Blyton is my aunt, and I am actually the boy George. But I don't want my aunt to give away my identity. That's why I've told her that you don't identify me as Shabana. You call me George. And then we would do all these adventures. And I didn't even know that you couldn't go to New York. You had to be in England for Enid Blyton. So those were the kind of, that was the kind of stuff that I fibbed around in school. And also, I didn't have to think much of what I wanted to do or what I wanted to be. My parents never gave me lectures. Everything was done by example. And in that example, there were no clear gender divisions. Because when my mother used to go off on tour, then my father used to look after us when he had to go, then my mother used to look after us. So that was what we took for granted. There was no clear role playing. So I didn't have to think. I was very interested in literature all along. But I didn't think that this is what I want to be when I grow up. Except that I think I inherited a love for acting almost by osmosis, because I would see my mother and how she would create a part and how she would inhabit a role. And it wasn't even as if I was fascinated by it, but it was something that I just took for granted. Everything was just taken for granted. What was consciously there was a love for India's composite culture, because I said that in spite of there being a complete absence of religion, Eid, Holi, Diwali, Christmas, all of these were celebrated. And I remember that on 26 January, we would all be put into a truck and taken to Chowpatty to watch the light. So it was a national festival, really, that we were celebrating. And that is something I took completely for granted.
So this is interesting that it created a free space in your imagination. Like, it was not bound by any identity. It was more like the world is your oyster.
Absolutely. There were no rules. There were no rules. There was nothing. When we shifted to Juhu, where my parents lived till they passed away, I had friends who were boys, and I was never told that you can't go out with so many boys. I'd come back from school and four or five boys and one, two girls, and we would go straight to the beach. And it was all just very, very, like you said, no sense of boundaries. It was a free space.
I can almost sense that feeling you had right now in your facial expression. That it's mm-hmm. almost this almost joyful, free kind of a, I have no limits kind of a feeling.
Yes.
So it was natural that you chose a creative profession. So who was responsible for formally bringing you into the world of theater?
I didn't get into theater. I got into film.
Oh, your first entry was into film?
Into film. Because then when I finished college, I decided that I would join the Film Institute. And I remember asking my father, I said, Abba, I'd like to take up acting. Will you support me in that? And he said, Bete, I will support you in anything that you do. If you decide that you want to become a mochi, I will support you in that also. Provided you tell yourself that I'll try to become the best mochi.
Shabana, can I say something? I want to interrupt you for a moment. This is exactly the same conversation I had with my mother. And she literally said the same thing. Even if you want to be a mochi, be the best mochi in the world. Literally exactly the same.
My God. So those were the times, you see. Those were the times, and that was what parents were telling their kids.
Yes.
It's giving me goose flesh.
I know. So you did go to FTII. And who are your batchmates, like from the artist?
Kamaljeet Singh, Rita Bhadri, Zarina Wahab, Neelam Mehra. These were my batchmates.
So Nasir also went to FTII, right?
Nasir went later to FTII. Nasir went, I think, 2 years later, because he was at the at NSD. Mm. So they did NSD, and then they did 1 year of the Film Institute. He and Om.
This is so interesting. I'm finding so many parallels in our journey. Actually, when I was at NID in Ahmedabad, every year, a P.K. Nair used to come with a whole bunch of movies and like start at 7 in the morning, go until 2 at night. And he would just basically teach us for a whole week how to appreciate world cinema.
Yes.
And I'm assuming he was there during your time also.
Yes, absolutely. Yes. We used to watch a film a day, two films a day at the Institute. And that's when I was exposed to international cinema, European cinema, Japanese cinema.
Yeah, he would bring Kurosawa's films and all of the other things. So which was your first film?
I had three first films, in a sense, because when I was a student at the Institute, K. Abbas, who was a friend of the family, he came and he signed me for a film called Fasla.
I remember.
Okay. Then literally days after I completed my diploma at the Institute with the best student in acting, gold medal for the best student in acting. Literally days after that, I was actually shooting for a film called Parinay.
Yes.
With Asla Satdev and Ramesh Sharma. So, and then I met Shyam Benegal, and he chose me for his film. And 18 days later, we were on the set in Hyderabad shooting Ankur. So in that sense, I have three first films. But the first film that got released was Ankur.
Wonderful. And it was... And then other two got released later.
Later, yeah.
Okay.
And then, of course, Ankur became a path-breaking film. And not only was it critically acclaimed, but it also did well commercially. And I got the National Award.
Right.
For the film, for my very first film. That's how it happened.
So one thing I'm curious about is like, filmmaking is a team effort, of course, and it's a lot of people's creative energies have to come together. But in the films that you participated in, who, like, was it the director, the producer, the actor, who brings in the thematic kind of core of the film?
In film, it's definitely the director. So they always say that film is a director's medium. Theater is an actor's medium, and television is a writer's medium. So film is a very collaborative effort, but ultimately the vision is that of the director.
That is interesting. So as you went through your film career, since director plays the central part in defining the core, did you feel constrained in applying your imagination, your creativity, or did you feel it was kind of a space created for you to blossom into?
No. I never felt constrained in it because I was consciously aware that it was a collaborative medium. And I had a deep respect for the director. And especially when you start with Shyam Benegal, although it was his first film, he was a master. You could sense that. And in the interaction that happened between him and the actors, there was no question of me feeling constrained or needing to ask questions. No.
So the other question I have is, you know, there are different kinds of films. One is like just typical masala films. And then there are others these days, like grand movies, like Bansali kind of movies. And then your kind of movies have a distinct character. They address deep social issues or like personal issues. They always make the audience reflect over what was said in the movie. So in that kind of a process, when the director chooses the actors, do your social and political views factor into the forming of the film?
You know, in fact, interestingly, the social views became even more concrete by the films that I chose. Because the films that I was making, I mean, there was, of course, Fakira and all that, which were pure commercial films. But the films that I was doing with Benegal, all of them were socially conscious films. And then I was working with Gautam Ghosh, who was also conscious films. And Mrinal Sen, who was also making socially conscious films. Mm-hmm. So what happens is you are born into a certain way of thinking because mm-hmm. of your parents and the atmosphere around you. And then when I chose to be in these films, they only concretized what I had believed in. And so a time came when I felt that I could no longer treat the work that I did as a 9-to-5 job and play characters who demanded social justice, who rose above the system. And then at 7 o'clock say, no, I'm putting on my air conditioners and I'm completely removing myself from the characters and the world they inhabited. It doesn't happen like that because some of the residue of the parts that you are playing are bound to filter in to your own life. And so it was with Gautam Ghosh's part where I, you know how I build a character, how I inhabit a character is by trying and finding someone close to the character that I'm playing and observing her and making her my role model. So there was this girl who used to sweep in the place we were living in. And she and I became friends. And so she said, Didi, will you come and come to my house for a cup of tea? And I said, of course I will. And when I went in and I saw her hut, I had never seen that kind of poverty before. It was a very small little space. There was no air. There was no light. 8 people were living in that very constrained space. And I felt, I felt that how could this person who's living in such adverse circumstances have the generosity to become my friend? And then I felt, my God, if I went back to Mumbai and didn't do anything for the people like her, then it would be a travesty of the faith she had placed in me as a friend. And I was quite seized by her. And then I came to Bombay and saw a documentary of Anand Patwardhan's called Bombay, Our City, where it said very clearly that demolitions is not the answer. Demolitions only create worse slums out of already existing slums. And then I joined the movement that was represented in the film called Nivaraha.
Yes.
And then after that, then I got involved in Nivaraha, and that's how I went on with the slum movement. Yes. So that was my involvement there.
That's beautiful. Another question, this is a provocative question, okay? Can you imagine Vivek Agnihotri inviting you to act in his movie?
Yes and no. Yes and no, because I used to know Vivek Agnihotri and his wife Pallavi Joshi had acted with Pallavi. And I saw Kashmir Files, and I always feel that everybody has a right to tell it from their lens.
Mm-hmm.
Point is, if we insist that only one kind of film is to be made, then we are being pretty dictatorial. Because the important thing is that every kind of film should be allowed to be made, and then people choose. I mean, those are the kind of books that are available. So why four films? Of course, it it all becomes about censorship and all of that. But it's not the end of the world if somebody makes a film like that. It's from their point of view.
So have you seen Kashmir File?
Kashmir File, I've seen.
How did you react to it?
I felt it was one-sided. I felt it was one-sided.
Did it feel like a film or a propaganda film?
I don't know. I don't know. It was a story, and it was a story told from one point of view.
So is there a division between using film to bring depth and understanding to social milieu versus films made to convey a specific point of view, more like a propaganda film?
Yes, but you can say the same thing to films that are made with about social justice, that are done more like propaganda rather than a human understanding. And that's not the purpose of films. If you want to make propaganda, then the feature film is not the medium. Then you bring out pamphlets, then you bring out books, then you pick it. You know, you do different kinds of things. Films have films as a medium, you should be truthful to the medium.
Yes.
That's what.
But even the truth lies in below beholder's eyes, right?
Yes, of course.
So what you think is the truth when you make your film would be totally different from when somebody else makes a film.
Yes.
So it's left to the audience to see both the lens and the visual that is depicted.
Yeah.
So since you said something, what I'm seeing from your response to my film, my question about Kashmir File, is that you have a large heart and you're ready to accommodate an extremely opposite perspective from your beliefs also.
You know, I feel that if you want to resolve something, it has to be done through dialogue and nothing else. And in dialogue, you have to actually hear what the other person is saying. Because if you don't hear, then you've already put up a wall and then you are not willing to move two steps towards that. So is it about just staying with the problem, or is it in trying to find a solution? And yes, there is a lot of propaganda, there's a lot of that, but there are some people who are genuinely hurt. And if they're genuinely hurt, then we have to listen to what it is that they're saying.
Absolutely.
Or then there's a construct. Of course, people take advantage of it, all of that. But the fact is, when people are genuinely hurt and you don't take cognizance of that for a long time, then it leads to violence. And that is my problem.
I understand completely and I agree with you. So in your view, in your imagination of India that you want to see emerge into the future, is there a place for radical ideologies such as RSS?
Yes.
And what is that place? Like, how far or how do you define their space in that future?
Anything. I am willing to accept anything, because to say no, only what we say is the truth is something that I don't believe in. And a lot of my colleagues disagree with me on this. So yes, I have place for the RSS. Anything. You see, when it starts leading to hatred towards a particular community, that's when there is a problem. Because that hatred then leads to violence.
Mm-hmm.
And anything that leads to violence is something that I would not encourage.
I understand. So how do you transform the hatred that is being unleashed in the world by a single ideology and restore them in a more egalitarian space?
That's just unacceptable. Ho hi nahi sakta. The whole concept of India is a plural one. You cannot have one monolithic idea of India because that's not what the country is. The beauty of the country is in its diversity. And that diversity has to be preserved at all costs. Otherwise, the very idea of India will disappear.
So do you believe that this composition that exists in the DNA of India will reject the virus of hatred?
It must. It must. Otherwise, what we will have will not be India. It will be something else. It will not be India.
So do you have hope or do you have anger in the current situation?
What I feel is at the moment, this whole Hindu-Muslim divide can be countered by the liberal Muslim taking on not the fundamentalist Hindu, but the fundamentalist Muslim. And the liberal Hindu should take on the fundamentalist Hindu. So you never allow it to become a Hindu-Muslim fight, but you make it a fight of the liberals against the fundamentalist, both liberal Hindu and Muslim on the same side.
Yes.
That, I feel, is the only way. Otherwise, everything will be reduced into Hindu-Muslim. And what we have to understand is how far back can we take history? How far? So what that does, you revisit history and create a pantheon of heroes and villains, and look at grievances in the past, some of them imaginary, some of them real, and make them the resource for political mobilization to garner votes.
Absolutely. And the truth is, you cannot change history.
No, it's also, from which point of view is history being read? You see, that's the whole point. That's the whole point. So if you say that Muslims raided Hindu temples, that's not the truth. The truth is that temples were the places where all the riches were. So anybody who came attacked that place to get the money, not because it was a Hindu-Muslim thing, but to explain this in this atmosphere of such hate and such division. You see, I feel what happens is that the religious heads also, they never come to the rescue of the community when it comes to issues of roti, kapda or makan, which is what the basic problem is. Whether you are Hindu, Muslim, Christian, Sikh or anything, what you're looking for is roti, kapda or makan. Then your religious heads, they can't do anything about it or they won't do anything about it. And then they'll whip up such communal frenzy that because it then becomes an emotional way of power. So you make this power, you take this power and you create this communal frenzy. And it is the fundamentalist in every case that does it, irrespective of the religion.
One sec. Okay, so this is fantastic. I'm just going to ask one side question before I ask my last question. You know, there's this whole, you worked with slum, people living in slums. You worked in Dharavi.
Not in Dharavi.
Not worked in Dharavi. But like, we live in a city in which Dharavi is a big part of our life. Do you think this project of redeveloping Dharavi is going to bring benefit to people? What's your imagination?
Well, I don't know what is the latest blueprint. In the earlier blueprint, the people were very unhappy. And we have to realize that building, multi-story buildings in a slum is not going to solve the problem. And you're doing that because you say then the rest of the place will be opened up. You know that will be opened up for anything but the slums. Now, if you look at the configuration of the slum dwellers, they need the space outside their homes because that's where they do the economic work.
Absolutely.
Whether it's making, you know, whether it is making papad or whatever it is that they do, the place outside that 220 square feet slum, the house, is the one that they need. Now, if you look at what they do in the slum redevelopment, is that they have put people into small little cubby holes and they've made one narrow, really narrow corridor in which they expect the old to sit, in which they expect the children to play ball, in which they expect the women to make their... It's disrupting their entire life. Because unless you give them open spaces, how are they going to live their lives? So what I am saying is when we talk of redevelopment, we have to speak to the people so that if you tell me I have to give my home up for progress, then I say I have to be the first recipient of that progress.
Yes.
That's very fair, isn't it?
Absolutely.
I have to be the first recipient, so I have to be somebody who's consulted and whose opinion matters. That doesn't happen. So we are very proud that we did a development program where the government of Maharashtra, a private builder, and Nivara Haq, the organization that I was with, have come together and build homes for free for 50,000 people. It is the largest single development project in Asia.
This is not Nivara Parishad, na?
Nivara Haq.
Acha. So because Mrunal Gore's Nivara Parishad was different.
That's different. Hmm. That's different. Yeah.
This is fantastic. In fact, this reminds me when my mother was an MP in Dadar Mahim Matunga Sayan area, I would go to the Machimar colony in Mahim near the causeway. And they had removed all the almost bungalows of the fishermen and put them in these like multi-storied buildings across the street. And I saw on the fifth floor, they had to dry their fishing nets in a narrow corridor. And the whole building sunk 4 feet down into the ground. So what kind of a lifestyle are you offering? And you don't even respect their dignity that they were the original owners of Bombay also.
Yes.
And you put them away in boxes, clearing the way for Back Bay reclamation, or not Back Bay, but the reclamation and progress. So I think this says the same thing, the same kind of a thought. And I don't know, probably the same thought applies to the entire redevelopment effort happening in middle-class families of Mumbai, where I don't think the original residents are ever seen as having the same rights as the new wealthy.
Having the legitimacy. Yes.
And so I think they are either seen as people who will sell and go away somewhere else, or people who do not deserve to get all the new amenities that you're going to provide. And I think there needs to be a change of mental attitude towards them also.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Because when I see, like, I live in Dadar and I see all the construction happening there, every building is going down and a new multi-storied building is coming up. If you see Lower Parel, where mills were removed and all the multi-storied buildings have come, I don't know how many original residents of that area even have a home there.
True.
So my last question, do you have hope?
Do I have?
Hope.
I'm an optimist. I'm an optimist like my father. I'm an optimist like my father, and I feel that for all the politics that are being played and all the hate campaigns and everything, they'll succeed up to a point, but not entirely, because the nature of India is such that it will not allow for it.
Oh, I'm so I feel so nice after listening to this. Because you are in the trenches and you hear people every day. And if that's what your feeling is, I feel very positive.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Shabana. And I'm in solidarity with you. And
very
good. And
there's a nara that we have, which is kamane wala khayega, lootne wala jayega, naya zamana aayega.
Zindabad. Thank you so much and I appreciate your time.
Okay, all right.
Bye-bye.
Thanks.
तुम इतना जो मुस्कुरा रहे हो तुम इतना जो मुस्कुरा रहे हो क्या गम है जिसको छुपा रहे हो क्या गम है जिसको छुपा रहे हो तुम इतना जो मुस्कुरा रहे हो में नमी हंसी लबों पर